Molweni, sanibonani kunonke. Thank you for joining us as we revisit our trip to the Sterkfontein Caves and Maritbeng Visitor Center, which are situated an hour's drive from Johannesburg and Pretoria. The area in which they are situated is known as the Cradle of Humankind. Sterkfontein is a South African National Heritage Site and was also declared a World Heritage Site in the year 2000. The Sterkfontein Caves are owned by the University of the Witwatersrand, whose scientists have been responsible for the main excavations at this World Heritage Site. They are credited with many of the most notable discoveries in the caves, including the world-famous fossils of Mrs. Ples and Littlefoot, the latter being an almost complete Australopithecus skeleton dating back more than 3 million years. The caves are open 7 days a week and children under 6 years of age get in free. You have to book your tickets online. I think this measure was implemented post-COVID-19 to manage traffic. Don't go to the caves with a new or sensitive hairstyle because everyone has to wear a hairnet and a mining hat. This is for your own protection because the caves get very narrow inside and one could easily bump their head while crawling through some sections of the cave. While we waited for the tour of the caves to begin, we were directed into the mini glass museum display of cave formations and geology, early life forms, mammals, and hominid fossils. Here you are introduced to Mrs. Ples, the Dawong child, and Littlefoot before heading underground to explore the caves.
Very good day, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Waza. I'm going to meet you guys for about an hour inside the caves. From here, we're going to take a 200 meters walk to the entrance. During the cave tour, we'll be about 60 meters underground. I just hope none of you is claustrophobic or asthmatic, ladies and gents. You are okay. So, ladies and gents, during the tour, we are allowed to take pictures. If you have any questions, no problem. Miss you, please.
Our walk to the caves had interdictions by the guide who shared knowledge on the area we were in. According to the guide, the top part of the caves covers about 53,000 hectares of land. To be honest, I can't actually imagine how big that is, but based on how he was emphasizing this fact, I can assume that 53,000 hectares must be massive. The area has 300 caves and 15 fossil sites. So essentially, when you are in the vicinity of the Sterkfontein caves, you are more likely to be standing over a cave than not. He said that in order to spot where a potential cave might be, one has to search for a cluster of trees. The trees you are looking for are mostly white stink oak trees and wild olive trees. Wild olive trees are evergreen all year round because they get water from dolomite. So if you see a cluster of the trees, it is very likely that there is a sinkhole below them. So as the guide says, be careful when you see the clusters, otherwise you might find yourself being the latest fossil in the area. As you walk towards the cave, there are plaques with little history pieces. Unfortunately, the guide moves so quickly, there is actually no time to read the plaques. Anyway, you could go back again after the tour has ended to read. Our four-year-old was the only child on the tour, and she was allowed into the caves too. This is a sundial. The guide demonstrated how it works. Alongside it is a stand that holds a rod, which is placed on the sundial according to the month and day of the year. Provided that the sun is out, the sundial should tell the approximate time. What makes Sterkfontein's millennial sundial unique is the fact that it has been positioned according to lines of longitude and latitude specific to Southern Africa. It tells the time accurately to within 5 to 10 minutes. And sure enough, the time it told on that day was accurate. Sundials date back to the Egyptian period around 1500 BC. They are considered to be the oldest known device for the measurement of time and the most ancient of scientific instruments. The use of sundials makes it possible to visualize our four-dimensional world, in essence, the three dimensions plus time, which is the fourth dimension. We then proceeded down into the caves. You have to wear sneakers or other comfortable shoes when visiting the caves because there's a lot of steep climbs down and up and long walks over rocks.
So where we are, if you take a look just from the roof, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see a bit of limestone. So 1896, we had miners coming down here looking for limestone. So they would use this in part of the extraction of gold and also building material. But now the challenge is, ladies and gentlemen, walking around the cave system, it was quite difficult. Hence they blasted some parts of the cave system. Mm-hmm. So today we don't see the natural cave, we just see a mine art cavity, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But listen then, so in my hand, I know some of you guys could have seen the skull. So this is a reconstruction of Mrs. Ples. So her actual name is Plesanthropus transvalensis. So Plesanthropus transvalensis means near human from the Transvaal, because Gauteng was called the Transvaal before. But now the Star newspaper couldn't pronounce the name perfectly, they cut it to Mrs. Ples. So making her the first adult ape man to be found in Africa. But now, in South Africa, ladies and gentlemen, we need to redeem ourselves. East Africa has been beating us for many years. So 1997, Professor Ronnie Clark, Stephen Mutumi and Wane Monepe discovered a skeleton which they named Littlefoot, which is the only concrete fossil to be found in the world. Yeah, but you're going to see the side as you go down properly. It's closed off because they took 15 years just to remove the fossil. So Littlefoot is complete from head to toe. She has the two feet in position. So she's the oldest fossil found in South Africa.
Where is she?
Wait, how old is she?
Littlefoot is 3.6 million years.
Oh. Sure.
But we're going to see the side properly because you see with the light, she all this wire is actually for the light on the other side.
Yeah, that's so cool.
So anyone can see it? You don't have nightmares today, guys. If you guys come closer, you might see over here. I know a lot of people say, this guy is playing with that mindset. But hey, ladies and gents, from where you guys are standing, we all see a piece of rock, ladies and gents. All of us.
Oh.
Until we look close, ladies and gents, you guys will see here the ribs. One, two, three.
No.
Backbone coming this side, and part of the animal's bone here.
No way.
But now looking at this whole thing, it looks like any piece of rock, ladies and gents. So this is a vertebrae column of a baby antelope, which could have been killed outside. Its bones were flushed out. But because it's one bone, it shows that this guy was killed first. If we had found the skeleton, we know it fell in the cave system.
Someone killed it?
Predators. Yeah. So we have to, dating of these things, antelopes in South Africa, they dated from 2 million years ago. And they broke out this part. If you look at this tiny formation, ladies and gents, of stalactites, it's been 125 years. These things haven't made a proper 2 to 3 centimeters.
Wow.
So these things take time to form. Yeah. So if you look at these ones, they could have formed maybe 20 to 30 million years ago.
Wow.
But it also goes with the amount of rainfall that we have, ladies and gents. So in Gauteng we have our summer rains. So there's going to be more dripping in summer compared to winter. To see where Mrs. Ples was discovered. And Mrs. Ples was found by Robert Broom back in 1947. Robert Broom was 81 years of age when he found the skull. But 4 years after that he died. Born and raised in Scotland. So he was also famous for finding dinosaurs and mammal-like reptiles in South Africa. But down there, ladies and gents, we have Philip Tobias. Mr. Tobias spent 50 years of his life working for this place. He discovered over 1,500 fossils alone. But now in 1999, this place was declared a World Heritage Site because of Philip Tobias. He was the first South African to follow paleontology as well. You know, at the age of 16, Mr. Tobias was already in medical school. So he's known also advanced as the head of anatomy. He used to lecture there teaching medicine science. He was nominated 3 times for Nobel Prize as well, Mr. Gentleman.
Oh.
Yeah, so he was one of those, you know, guys that had patience, Mr. Gentleman. But Mr. Gents, from me and these two guys, we would like to thank you for coming to this place and have a wonderful weekend. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
At the end of the tour, there is a tip box, so make sure to bring some cash with you so you can tip the guide. I know most people try not to walk around with cash, but please do remember to bring a note or two. If you're a mother with a 4-year-old like me, make sure to bring a towel for carrying your bundle of joy for the entire tour. For the entire hour inside the cave, I carried my bundle of joy on my back. This was about 200 steep steps, reaching a depth of 60 meters underground through small, narrow passageways that I crawled through on my hands and knees with a 4-year-old human weight on my back. The greatest thing about the caves is that the temperature is a constant 18 degrees Celsius. Ordinarily, I would be complaining about how cold it is, but on that tour with a child on my back, I welcomed the cool air that made my little human weight feel less heavy. When you come out of the caves, you are given the option to take one of two routes. One is a short route straight back to the visitor center. The other is a scenic route around the caves. We took the scenic route with views of the Cradle of Humankind. Notice how my knees have a bit of mud on them? Yeah, that, ladies and gentlemen, is one of the perks of being a mother, crawling through holes with a 4-year-old on your back. While on the topic of the narrow pathways, if you have knee issues, suffer from claustrophobia, and you are very obese, I would not recommend that you do the tour because the very narrow passageways will be very unpleasant for you. 11 kilometers away from the caves is Marubeng, an interpretation center for the caves. We decided to take a drive to Marubeng after visiting the Sterkfontein caves. The Marubeng Visitor Center is an award-winning world-class exhibition focusing on the development of humans and our ancestors over the past 4 million years. The self-guided interactive tour allows you to take all the time you need to ponder humanity's fascinating origin story. Unfortunately for us, when we visited Marubeng, it was closed, so we decided to head back home. On our way home, we stumbled on a market at a place called Agri-Fish Farms. I don't know if the market is always there or if it is a Halloween special, but it was the perfect way to close off our day with a relaxed meal in a place with live music and kiddie play facilities. If you made it to the end of this video, I think it might be a wise decision to hit the subscribe button so you can join us on our next adventure. See you next time. Bye.